Good evening. Thank you. Good evening and welcome to another edition of Extramural Lectures. We have today with us one of South India's most sought-after filmmakers, Mr. Gautam Vasudev Menon. Mr. Gautam went into college with the idea of becoming an engineer, but came out a filmmaker. He trained under Rajiv Menon on his first feature film, Minsara Kanavu. In 2001, Gautam came out with his first film, Minale, and its Hindi version the very next year. What followed were a series of movies in a plethora of genres that cemented his place in the cinema industry. He has brought out Kaka Kaka, Vetayadu Vilayadu, called the police duology by the media and fans around. Varanam Ayiram, a story based on... Varanam Ayiram, a story based on his father, fetched him a national award in 2008. His film Vinay Thandi Varuvaya was famous for his music. Nadunisi Naigal, a critically acclaimed film in 2011, carried no music scores at all. His movies in other languages include Yeto Velipoindi Manasu, Garshana, Emaya Chesave, Ek Diwana Tha, and Rehna Hai Tere Dil Mein. Mr. Gautam has worked with top maestros like Ilayaraja and A.R. Rahman. He is currently filming a big one starring Ajit and... May call upon Professor Preeti Agalyam to welcome the speaker with a fruit basket. May now call upon Mr. Gautam Vasudev Menon to deliver his much anticipated talk.
Good evening. I'd actually like to say I have nothing to say, but I'm expected to say something, I think. My problem is when I come to an college, especially an engineering college, in something like IIT, I'm wondering why talk about film and, you know, ask you guys to come into the industry and tell you about what I've faced in life and stuff like that, because it seems just... Somewhere it seems pointless. I think the professors are going to be frowning upon me and stuff like that. But what helps today is informal kind of setting, you know, so that eases a little tension off me. I was expecting one, you know, very formal sort of a setup, and thankfully it's not that. But I still have a problem about talking about films and stuff like that. But somewhere when Sudarshan suggested, why don't you talk about life, films and everything else in between, I thought, okay, why not? You know, let me just, you know, freewheel and stuff like that. So I haven't come prepared with a speech or anything like that. So I'm just going to go with the flow. And I'm going to ask you to direct me because I'd like this to be as interactive as possible. So I'm hoping there is a mic that's passed around and stuff like that. Also, life, you know, the topic itself will make me look back at life and what's been. And I don't want to do that because if I do that, I might just think that, you know, I haven't done anything in life as yet. You might ask me if that's even possible. It is. Just because I'm standing here and talking and you guys are sitting there listening to me doesn't mean I'm a super achiever or anything like that. You know, if you ask me personally, I think I'm here. In my head, at least, I think I'm here because of the gray on my head. Or maybe, you know, in my heart, I'm thinking I'll be able to sort of, you know, give away some life lessons to you guys based on what I've seen in life. Not because I'm some achiever or anything like that. Because for me, every film... is work. It's like me stepping out to work just like anybody else in the IT industry or a lawyer or a doctor would do. I step out from work and I talk film, I discuss film, and I make films. And when I'm not making films, I talk about what I'm going to make, you know, over the next week or the week after next. So for me, I don't want to look back at life. The last time I looked back at life and what's been was when my father passed away, you know, and I was on an aircraft knowing that my father has just passed away and I'm flying back to sort of see him off on his last journey, and it set off a whole roller coaster of moments in my head, and I thought, hey, hold on. And I, in that, on that aircraft, I remember opening my laptop and putting down all those moments that I remembered from the first time I saw my father till, you know, when I saw him just last week when I left on that trip. And that's the story of Varuna Mairam also. I thought, you know, what if an army officer is returning back home when he hears about his father's, you know, passing away, and why not set off, a journey of moments and emotions and stuff like that. So if this is going to set off something like that, well, that got me a national award. I'm really happy about that. I need to see where this is going to go, because I really don't want to start thinking about life and what's been. Also, I might just end up thinking how much I've changed. Am I still the simple guy that, you know, I've always wanted to be? Have I changed so much from that? Or, you know what I'm saying, right? I think I am, but I might just think I'm somebody else right now. There's a song that comes to my mind. I have no intention of singing and stuff like that, but I'm thinking, why not? You know, I'm thinking, why not? So, वक्त ने किया क्या हसी सितम तुम रहे न तुम हम रहे न हम वक्त ने किया क्या हसी सितम तुम रहे न तुम हम रहे न हम वक्त ने किया. So, why am I singing this song? Because I was just reminded that the words in the song, tum rahe na tum, hum rahe na tum, hum talks about you are no longer you and I am also no longer myself. So, I'm thinking, have I changed? Now, I'm just going to be freewheeling. So, how many of you have actually listened to the song before? Have you heard the song? Can you just put up your hand? I just want to know how many of you have heard the song before? Okay, just 4 or 5 people. Can you just put your hand? I'm just doing a little... I'll tell you why I'm going on this line. Okay, so the others, please just pay some money and download the song and just keep it on your iPods and stuff like that. I'm very insistent about paying money because musicians still benefit from the work that they've done, you know, a long while ago. And, you know, with all the new Copyright Act and stuff like that, you buy a song for 3 rupees or 4 rupees, that money goes to the musicians and the singers and stuff like that. So please pay some money and buy the song and just listen to it when you're feeling blue and stuff like that. I think at some point, like I sang the song to you today and you heard me singing Vakt Ne Kiya, and somewhere, you know, 3-4 people get together and probably pull out that song. Good things will come your way. There's no way that good things will not come your way is what I'm thinking, you know, as I'm saying this. So we were talking about life and how I don't want to go back looking at life and all that. But since I've been asked to do that, let me just probably try and go back to see, you know, where this journey started for me. And somewhere I'll try and just see if you guys can somewhere get inspired or at least know what to do and what not to do, you know, once you get out of college and stuff like that. So for me, like my profile says and like how Sudarshan pointed, I walked into an engineering college to study engineering because that's what my mom wanted me to do. And I walked out of there wanting to become a filmmaker because somewhere along the way, my interest in Tamil and Tamil stories and my writing and my own awareness about films and wanting to write started in college, sitting in class while the lectures were happening and stuff like that. I used to write short stories. And I met friends, you know, in college who are still my friends today. My school friends are all over the place and I'm not so much in touch with them, but 4 or 5 guys from college, we still meet up and we're really good friends and there's nothing we don't know about each other. So college was a tremendous experience for me, which is why, like I was telling, you know, ma'am earlier, that when people come to me and ask if they can work with me, under me, I insist on them having completed college before they get into this line, because somewhere that sort of streamlines you, and I've said this many times before, you know, that education, that being with friends, being on a campus, being in a school, being in a hostel or whatever, you know, that sort of gives you one roundedness that is so important, you know, when you start working and stuff like that. It's also about taste and what style you sort of acquire and stuff like that. That's so important in the line of work that, you know, I am in. So college did all that for me. You know, I completely loved every minute of it. I remember during the third year, I only had about 4 or 5 papers, as arrears and stuff like that. And I did something really stupid, which at that point seemed nice. I had a problem with one of my, there's a subject called applied mechanics. I completely hated it. And I hated the lecturer also who was, handling class for me. And he used to just pick on me for everything, and we generally had a problem. We didn't like the way each other looked and stuff like that. So I decided I'll teach him a lesson one night. And I walked up to his room, one night, middle of the night, and I put a nice big lock outside his door, and I threw the key away and I went off. So the next morning, no, you're not supposed to applaud here. This is not good stuff. You're not supposed to applaud here. So next morning, I did this that particular night because I knew the next morning there was a major meeting happening in college, and he was in charge, and I knew if I do this, he wouldn't be able to go on time and all that. And he ended up getting out of the room only at 1 o'clock as opposed to the 9 o'clock appointment that he had. But somewhere, what that did was, it told me that friendships can just change just like that. People can change just like that, because he being smart, I also wrote some obscenities on the wall in English, and at that time in that particular college, there were only a few guys who could speak good English. So straight away it was narrowed down to about 4 or 5 students, And then they picked one of my friends and they told him that if you don't squeal on who did this, we'll, expel you from college and stuff like that. So turn the heat on him. And he very easily said, Gautam is behind this. There was also another guy with me who carried the key, I think. What happened was my parents were, there was immediately a notice on the board which said I'm suspended for the rest of the year until, an inquiry and stuff like that. And my dad and mom were brought in, and I felt really bad because I thought this needn't have gone to dad and mom and stuff like that, but it did. So my dad had to come all the way from, Chennai. Not all the way, but he had to come. He had to come anyway and meet and apologize on my behalf and stuff like that. So that sort of opened my eyes. What I also did was it added another 6 papers onto my already existing arrear list. And I was just not able to finish, in time. And I had to go back 6 months later and stuff like that. So that single moment sort of changed a lot. It also told me that this guy was not my friend. And I knew him really well. And it told me at that point, that was the first lesson in life, so to speak. Anyway, I will come to why I'm saying that a little later. So then I moved out of college and I was so keen on filmmaking. And the only, the best thing about that was my dad and mom were like, do whatever, your heart tells you to do. There was just no stopping or even questioning, oh, you finished your engineering, why do you want to get into this? What kind of money you will make? Nothing at all. My dad said, just do it. That's what your heart desires, and just go ahead and do it. But do you know how to go about it? Because nobody's from the film industry. And the thing is, at that point, when I finished college or when I got into college, I didn't even know there was a film institute for me to study in. I don't know, this today's age and generation, people know so much. But I think, this is 1989. Yeah, I passed out of school in 1989. I didn't know there was a film institute. So I finished 4 years of engineering and I came out. And then I realized, okay, there's a film institute. I could have gone and studied there. But I thought, why spend 2 more years doing that? So straight away, I started looking for work. I did some work in Wipro for a bit, selling AutoCAD software and stuff like that. And then I found, solace with Mr. Rajiv Menon, who just looked at me and said, start work tomorrow. And that opened up a whole new, world for me. It was the world of films, which I completely loved. I sat back and watched how shots were filmed, how, from paper, with just material on paper, a whole make-believe world was being created in front of a camera with the actors and technicians and everybody working for that. Completely unreal. Everything was false about that. But we actually got permission to do that. We were getting road permissions. We were getting permissions from the secretary to shoot on roads. And a whole crew comes together, light and everything. And we were making a make-believe sort of moment, which, suspension of disbelief and all that stuff. But it seemed like nothing else to me in the world, So I completely got into it and I assisted him. And at some point, I had a problem with the way, Rajiv sir was talking to me. In the sense, for everything, there would be, anger and stuff like that. So I decided, this is not how I'd like to work. So I just called him. I just went up to him one day and said, sir, I'd like to move on. I'm quitting. He said, you don't know anything. You've just done one film with me. You should work on 3 or 4 more films. So I said, it's okay, sir. I'll learn by myself. I probably think I'm there, but I will probably learn by myself. And I moved on from there, set up my own sort of an ad film production house, did some small ad films and stuff like that, and then started writing scripts. And see, there was no dream as such. There was no dream film and this is what I want to do and stuff. I just went with the flow. All I knew was I wanted to be a filmmaker. And then somewhere, you know, somebody introduced me to Madhavan one day. We were meeting at a restaurant, and I just, in that 10, 15 minutes, I just narrated an idea to him. And this wasn't a meeting to narrate an idea. But I think I did that, and otherwise Minnale wouldn't have happened, and I wouldn't have been here, because he heard the idea in that 15, 20 seconds, a story about two guys who don't like each other, and then they end up falling, you know, for the same girl, which is an age-old story, but we just told it a little differently, I think. He liked it. He said, yeah, let's put this together, and slowly more meetings happen and stuff like that. I used that opportunity that I got, you know, for about 10 minutes, and in that I managed to tell him a little idea. And then I just went with the flow, and Minnale happened, the producer fell into place. I met Harris, you know, who at that time also was starting off like me. We just hit it off. We made some great music on that film, and as every song unfolded, I knew these songs I like, and I always worked like that. More than thinking what the audience would like, I always worked on whether I will like this or not, and I liked it, being somebody who listens to music all the time. I just liked the songs, and I said, let's just go with this and stuff like that, and we made a film. But somewhere there was a producer, there was Vivek, there were a lot of other people who were helping me, you know, put that film together. And the film did well, you know, people appreciated it and stuff like that. But I felt I hadn't come into my own. I felt this was just a sort of a visiting card, you know. I needed to get out there and do something else. So my actually dream film is already done with. I'm just surviving right now based on spur of the moment thoughts and what I see in life and stuff like that. So Kaka Kaka was that film for me. You know, for the people from Andhra Pradesh, it's Garshana that was made at that point. I wrote this little idea when I was in college itself. It's about an encounter specialist who doesn't have anybody in life, and hence nobody becomes his weakness. But the minute he falls in love with somebody, he knows she's going to be his weakness. And so he keeps pushing that thought away from his head. But you can't say no to love, you know, and you can't say no to a good-looking woman. So, you know, he falls in love, and sure enough, she becomes his weakness, and they target that, you know. So this was the line that I'd written while I was in college. And that was my dream film. I ended up making that film in my second film itself. And I was telling ma'am, that film had some cult filmmaking and different kind of editing and stuff like that, but nothing was planned. It was the only way I could have made that film. They say, like, I know Surya, I have to keep talking about, you know, Surya. Recently in an interview, he had said, you know, we have to keep up with the time and stuff like that. But I don't know if I can make Kaka Kaka any other way. Like, even if I make it now, I know there's films like Sudhu Kavum and Jigar Danda and all coming up, and very new age and stuff like that. But I can't dream of making that film in any other way. Close my eyes and I'd still make the film the same way. So Kaka Kaka put me sort of on the map. I'm saying this because the next call came from somebody whose films I've watched, I've grown up with, admired, you know, Mr. Kamal Hassan, who called me and said, let's meet. And that was unbelievable, because for me, growing up was about watching Kamal sir films, you know, Nayagan, Satya, this kada was worn while Satya happened, you know, stupid, but yeah, that's how it happened. You know, we used to wear our trousers up here at that point, you know, just because Kamal sir wore his trousers like that, you know, so we've all been through the whole, you know, 9 yards. So that call came and I thought, okay, finally, you know, something has happened. But that was the, it was enjoyable and all that, but it was the most frightening experience of my life. Because imagine having to direct Kamal sir. Like, you have to tell him a scene, you have to narrate a shot, you have to tell him this is the way I expect, you know, the scene to unfold and stuff. Like, it was the most frightening experience, because with every shot he'll look at me like that, and he's got powerful eyes. He can hold you like that, you know. He'll look at me like that, and in my head it'll be, this is not how I wanted it. Because on paper, I would have thought a little more, a little subtle. So I'll think, should I go and tell him or not? If I don't tell him, the shot is not going to come out the way I wanted it. So I will go up to him and say, sir, can we just do it a little differently, sir? Yeah, na pannadu ungalku pudikalaya? He'll like, why, you don't like what I did, is it? So how can you tell him, no you don't like, I don't like it. So I'll say, illa sir, it's just that on paper, you know, I had something else. Neenga konjam panni kaaminga, he'll say. Which you should never do, because you can't show Kamal sir how to act. And this he's already told me before, you know, you shouldn't show me how to act. You tell me and I will act. So I said, sir, I don't know how to act, but I know that this can be a little different. So somewhere I managed to get along, you know, that I got that film done just like this, with this little extreme, not a little, extreme fear in my heart, but managed to put together a film. And then wait here, it happened. And since then, you know, I can keep talking about every film of mine, but since then it's been a journey. Now, from this, the offshoots that are in my head are stuff like, I wish I'd made a slightly less violent film, because I realized that when I was watching Vetiyada Vilayada in the theaters, my son who was 2 years old, you know, I was trying to shut his eyes, and I was like, why did I make this film and I can't even show my son this film? My wife was staring at me saying, we should have brought him to the theater. I said, yeah, I just didn't realize it. But I did something intelligent at that point where, just before the release of the film, I remembered my producer telling me that we managed to get a U certificate for the film. I said, no, this is not a universal film. It's an adult film, so at least push for a UA. I mean, let's just at least get an UA. He said, no, we'll lose money. I said, no, sir, please let's get an UA. And we managed to get a UA. But still, at that point, I realized that maybe I should have toned down the violence so that, audience from all classes and ages can watch the film and stuff like that. So I'm just talking about what all, you know, I came across in life and how things changed for me. And then Varanamayiram happened. Varanamayiram was, of course, a sort of a very emotional journey for me because I was coming back, like I mentioned earlier, and my father had passed away and all these thoughts came up, and Surya was waiting for a year for me for a script. And I just went up to him after the funeral and everything and said, I have an idea. It's about this army officer who's coming back to his father's funeral, and his life sort of unfolds in front of his eyes, and you see a journey. It's a coming of age film. And you see a simple guy, a simpleton from Ananagar, you know, who goes through this and stuff. And he loved it. And we ended up making a very nice film. And at least we thought it was nice. And initially we felt, you know, it was long and audience was like, it's too emotional and stuff like that. But it stuck. It stayed. You know, people liked it. And we took it forward. And then the National Award happened and stuff like that. Did it make money? Yes, it made money. But if you ask the trade pundit out there, is this the kind of film that he'd like somebody like a Surya to do now, they'd probably say no, but I just don't give a damn. I've never bothered about that. I've always thought that I should make films that I feel comfortable about and that's straight from the heart and that I'm passionate about. It's the kind of film that I'd like to sit in the theater and watch. Result of which, yes, I haven't made too much money in life and the last few years have not been so great and stuff like that. But seriously, that's not what life is all about. Now I'm going to start talking about how you meet certain people in life and how things just go awry at some point. So when we started this company at some point earlier, you know, much before Kakaka happened, there were people who came up to me from, you know, guys from college who came up and said, let's start a company together. They seemed like good friends and stuff like that. And we took them on, we brought them in and we started a company. But today they're not with me because they've all found their own space and they've moved on in life and stuff like that. So how do you know who is the right guy to be with? Who is the person that you can sort of trust and bring into your fold? I guess you'll never know, but somewhere I'm hoping that when you guys leave colleges and move on, and when you meet people and when you're setting up businesses and looking to, you know, collaborate with somebody, just step back to think, is this the right move? Sometimes you just don't go with your heart. You know, sometimes head matters a lot. You have to step back and think. Because today I realized that, you know, what I set up earlier for about 10 years, those guys are not there with me, but two new people who actually formed something in me 2-3 years ago are with me now. And I was wishing these people had come in earlier in life, but that didn't happen, right? So, but how do you take that call in life? You don't know. This is what I was talking about. I'm hoping I'd be able to give you a few life lessons. This is one of those lessons. Step back to just think who your friends are and who you should collaborate with. Is this the right step? And just don't go with your heart all the time. You need some head to come into it also. Having said that, I sang a song, and I believe music is something that can definitely, shape your day to a large extent. I believe in a song a day. You know, I believe in listening to a song a day, which somewhere, you know, sort of calms me down, soothes me from whatever I'm doing. And I search for one particular song. If I'm not able to find, I search for one particular song. And I'm sure all of you here are somewhere musically inclined. Today, I'm very happy to say that I'm making my own music. It's not going to go out into film as yet because I'm still, you know, in the good company of people like Mr. Rahman and Harris and Raja Sir and stuff like that. So I don't want to put my own music out, but somewhere there are these tunes that play in my head. And if I hum, these are tunes that are in my head and these are new tunes. So I kind of step back and put these tunes together. You know, these days with the iPhone, you can do a lot of stuff. So I just record into the phones and I keep, you know, putting these tunes in place. And I've also ended up recording these songs, and I've met Tamrei and Madan Karki and have done lyrics for these songs and recorded these songs and have sung and stuff like that. Somewhere, you know, music keeps me going. I don't know if you've been reading up on me and stuff, but the past 2 years have not been so great. And this happens to any filmmaker or anybody in life, you know. It's not going to be easy at all out there. But what this has done is it's at least made me understand that the lows that I faced are very early in life. I'd rather face these lows much early than go another 10 years and then have to go back another 5 years. You know, I'd rather not do that. So we made a film called Nidane and Punvasanam, which when I read on paper was a very sweet script. And, you know, I said, let's make this because that's how I make films. I like something, I don't think twice, I go ahead and make it. And that film, at the end of that film, yeah, the film didn't do as well as expected, but the producer had issues with that film, and he just, you know, filed case after case on me saying, you know, the film was supposed to be made in London, but they made it in Chennai, and he promised to work with Mr. Rahman, but he worked with Mr. Raja. I mean, will somebody have a problem with me working with Ilaiyaraja, sir? I mean, that's unheard of. But I said, okay, fine. You know, if that's the way you're looking at films, fine, I'll face you. And I went through the whole 2 years of fighting this guy in court and stuff like that. But today, and those moments only brought me closer to my team. You know, I have two partners with me. One of them is from the IIT, actually. He has nothing to do with films. I have him because he is my rock-solid partner who will tell me, no, this film, you want to work with Kamal, sir? Yeah, all that is fine, but we'll end up spending 50 crores. I'd rather make a 10 crore film and not make a 50 crore film. That's his IIT, IIM background speaking, you know. So I need people like that around me also. And then I have somebody like a Reshma who will tell me, just don't listen to Venky, let's just go ahead and make the film, you know. So that's the balance that I strike, and I'm happy that we stuck together through these 2 years, faced all sorts of stuff being written about us, films being shelved and stuff like that. But today I stand here, I mean, it's just a small crowd, yes, but I stand here happy, not afraid to face life, and knowing that I'm shooting a big film with somebody like an Ajit who calls me and says, let's just make a film because I've always loved working with you. You know, that's what matters. It's films like Varanamayiram and Kaka Kaka that's brought me here today. Otherwise, why would big heroes want to work with me is what I'm thinking. So, absolutely no regrets in life at all. Very, very happy about how things are working out. And the two, three key things that I thought I must talk about here is the fact that college, this whole atmosphere, you know, as I was driving in the whole campus, I just wish, I have no regrets about life and time passing and stuff like that. I'll never crib about the fact that I'm 42, because I know there's somebody who's 50, there's somebody who's 55, there's somebody who's 60, and if I crib about being 42, and there's somebody who's also at 60 who'll wonder why is he cribbing about being 42 when I'm at 60, you know. So no regrets about life, but moments like this when I was driving and I was thinking, oh man, how nice would have been studying in a campus like this, you know. So just make the most of those moments. I mean, these will not come to you later, they'll just fly away. Today, when I look back, I was in college, you know, in 89 and 93, and I had all sorts of fun. But today, I wish I could go back to that time and pick up the lead guitar and sing on stage and stuff like that. You know, I want to relive those memories, those moments and stuff like that, but I've moved on. So hold on to those moments. There's so much more available to you compared to us and, you know, older people, you know, who from then on have managed and who are still doing so well. So hold on to those moments. Know who your friends are and who you collaborate with in life. And it's good to face those lows right up there at the beginning itself, because you don't want to face those lows later in life. Please don't let me go on anymore. Please ask me questions. Badger me. I'm ready to answer your questions. I'm all yours. Thank you.
Sir, how did you get the idea of MISAVEN?
So, I mean, if I had actually prepared a speech, that's probably what I would have talked about. I sort of make films from life. From what I see, there are these people who will tell you, thank you. There are these people who will tell me, and they will tell you, and you'll read about it, that, you know, when you, as an audience, you go to the theater thinking, you don't want to watch films from life. You want to be completely suspended in disbelief and or belief, and you want to just watch films that will take you into this fantasy world and then come back to reality when you go back home and stuff like that. I don't give a damn, as I said earlier. I'd still like to make films that speak, you know, reality, that speak about life and from what I've seen and stuff like that. All the films, like including Kaka Kaka, if you ask me the story of an encounter specialist, yes, I did meet a couple of cops, and one of those cops told me this line. He said, when I leave home, my wife doesn't know if I'll come back home that particular evening. Because I am an encounter specialist, I've handled a couple of cases, I've knocked down a couple of gangsters, and there have been threatened phone calls every week. And there's been one guy who called up my wife and said, "Iniki night na vella podu anpra ungalku, I'll send you a white sari home." And, you know, as cliche as it sounds, but that is the truth. So I actually drew from him a lot. Likewise, Varanamayiram, like I said, was completely about life, except the, you know, the whole drug phase and the alcoholic phase. I'm not trying to be a good guy out here, but I don't do that. But that was the cinematic, you know, thing that I added in the film. Likewise, Yemaya Chesava, which is Vinetandi Varuvai, was about somebody I had met and known in life. There was somebody who lived right upstairs, and this happened, you know, to them and to her and stuff like that. And I, at some point, I called her up and said, I'm going to make a film. It has you, and it's going to be about you. And, you know, I'm really sorry, but don't curse me later and stuff like that. And I ended up making that film. The few editions were, you know, about Simbu Chaitanya wanting to become a director, which is my own story coming in and stuff like that. So everything is drawn from life. There's nothing that's not drawn from life at all.
What can you suggest to a person who is studying in IIT and want to become a movie maker?
Yeah, so I mean, as long as the professors don't hate me for saying this, I'm saying Finnish, we want people like you around. Like I said, Venkat Somasundaram, who's from the IIT, is the partner in my company, and he completely handles all my the funding and the planning and everything like that. Apart from that, the people who come to work with me are all, you know, professional, qualified, educated people. We love people like you to come into the industry. What will happen is, it'll become a much better industry with professionals coming in, you know, it'll become corporate. The whole funding process will change. We are still borrowing, you know, at 3.5% interest. I'm sure you know what that means. You know, we're still borrowing, paying interest every month, and those costs can never be seen on film. We just shell out so much money for interest because I can't bring money from my home because I don't have. If I had, I wouldn't be at the mercy of these guys. But we have to depend on people like that for funding. If people like you come in, we could get corporatized and funding would come in and you'll give us ideas, you know, to list companies and to invest abroad and stuff like that. So we, you know, just finish that degree and come over. I'd really welcome people like you over. Yeah.
Would you suggest us to do any film courses after completing
this? Not necessary. I mean, after studying 4 years in the IIT and probably another 2 years, you don't need to go through another 3 years of the Film Institute, I mean, which is what I did. You need to work with the director to sort of, you know, train under him to see, you know, what unfolds and how a film is made. That one particular film is very, very important. And it's how much you contribute to the making of that film. So I have a team of 10, you know, and I don't tell them anything. I will never tell them that you're in charge of this or you're in charge of that. Everybody has to be involved in every aspect of filmmaking, and I think they're having a good time, so, yeah.
Sir, you have done films with Surya, Kamal, as well as Tala, and what have you learned from each of them?
I think I've gone through the whole Surya and Kamal sir experiences. Like I told you how I felt while working with Kamal sir, legend and everything, but there was this fear in my heart. Today, I'm making a film with Ajit sir, and it's, again, see, that's another experience because it's enlightening again, because after having made 13 films all put together, I'm working with a superstar actor who's so simple and who walks in and says hello, shake hands personally with everybody for about 15 minutes before he starts to, you know, come to me and say, okay, what's the shot for today? He doesn't have to do that, and people don't do that. You know, he walks in, he talks to everybody, even he might not know them personally, but he will ask them, you know, is everything okay? He told me, I do this because, you know, they're coming away from their homes to work with me on this particular day. And I know if I reach out to them, they'll forget whatever problems and troubles they have, you know, while they left home or, you know, all sorts of stuff. And I know that'll make them feel comfortable. So I do that consciously, and I do that because I want to do that. So, you know, every experience is a humbling experience for me, including this one.
So do I need to be strong in Tamil writing to make Tamil films?
Yeah, and it's not difficult to learn the language. Like, I studied Hindi in school, but if you study in Chennai, you end up speaking Tamil anyway. Like, my kids study Hindi, but I know they will speak Tamil, and today there's a third language where you can learn Tamil. But ultimately, when you're making Tamil films, you need to read at least the language. You don't have to write, because I write myself in phonetics. So Ingava is I-N-G-A-V-A. You know, so it's important to read and know the language, read stuff in Tamil, but not necessarily that you should write. I mean, don't kill me for this, but yeah.
Hi, sir. You have done your engineering and suddenly you have shifted to the filmmaking. Do you think you have done justice to your engineering, and how about your criticisms you faced by your friends and family? How did you overcome that?
No criticism at all from friends and family. I mean, I was, my mom and dad especially, like I said, they never said a negative word about my choice and what I wanted to be and stuff like that, absolutely. And like I said, I think it's about being streamlined and that whole college experience, more than the engineering aspect of it. Yeah, today I'm able to, you know, teach my son some math and physics at home because of what I've learned, yes. I don't think I was too bad a student in school especially. I was decent. I got about 85% marks, you know, when I passed out and stuff like that. Don't ask me about college because that was a, you know, completely different experience. But that education and that whole 4 years in college is always so important that I would never regret not having pursued that, because somewhere it helps me make films. That whole professional attitude, you know, somewhere being corporate has come from college. So there's no regrets about not having pursued engineering at all.
Sir? Your movies like Kaka Kaka, Vetayadu Velayadu and Pachakili Muthucharam, those negative roles will be portrayed in such a unique way, such that those characters will be established in your mind compared to heroes like Pandya, and Illamaran. So how do you get those ideas?
I think we all like the little negative streak. We can't be something and we like a little negative streak, which is what I am too. You know, I also believe, and most good, sensible heroes will understand that for the hero's character, the protagonist, to work out, you need a strong antagonist. You need a powerful villain for the hero to stand out. It's the old, you know, MJR sir formula. You know, throughout the film, you can see that, you know, Saroja Devi will be dancing and everybody else will be doing comedy and stuff like that. And MJR sir will come up just towards the end and a couple of fights and he will win the hearts of the audience. He let the villain hold fort, you know. So it's been going on for quite some time. So you need to let the villain stand out for the hero to stand out at the end. So it's just that formula, which when I write, you know, automatically falls in place, I think.
Good evening, sir. This is Srikanth. First of all, I'm your very great fan, and you can see a copy in my hand.
Okay.
So I'm being wearing this after watching your Varanam Aayiram.
Okay.
And that has really moved my life, and it's very close to my heart. Also, I have a habit of writing letters to the filmmakers once I see the movie, and one such letter is this. But it's not compilation of everything, but I have a gist of things that I have to tell you, and I have in this, and I want to give it to you. Do I get that opportunity to?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Sir, good evening. Sir, sir, why do you have MI Chesave Telugu version and the Tamil version?
Why do I have a different ending?
Yeah.
Which is why I'm hoping people like you will come into the industry and fund and invest in us and, you know, set up corporate companies and stuff like that. Because there was a producer who helped us fund the film and she insisted that there shouldn't be a sad ending because the Telugu audience won't like it. So the Tamil film was my own. I was able to do what I wanted with it. But with the Telugu film, there was somebody sitting on my head and saying, no, the Telugu audience will not like a sad ending, so can you make it a happy ending and stuff like that. So the Hindi film also had a happy ending, but the Hindi film didn't work anyway, so there's no point in talking about it. So.
Sir. Good evening. Sir, can you share some moments or some events where you really frustrated or a kind of failure moments, if there are any?
Oh,
can
lots.
You share? Okay, thank you.
So I was telling ma'am a little earlier that when I write and when I'm making a film, I just don't give a damn about the audience. I just write it the way I want to write it, thinking this is what the script deserves, and I make the film without anybody bothering me, unless there are people like the producers who come along, which I'll still manage to get my own into it. I don't care about, you know, if they say, can you do something here or can we keep a punchline there and stuff. Like, I just make it the way I want to make it. Now, some of you might not like it. I'm saying that's the way I make my films. But when those films are about to release, just about a day or two before the release, I disappear from the face of the earth. You won't see me at all because I go into a complete shell thinking, oh my God, what's going to happen now? I always think if I just made some changes and if I'd listened to a few more people, maybe, you know, I wouldn't have felt like that. But then I'd rather go through this than, you know, having stuff taken away from my own heart. So I go through those moments of despair and fear and everything, which I think I've understood that every creative guy goes through. The films do well, and most of my films, including Varanam and Kaka, have been not been taken well when the film released. So on day one and day two, I'll get calls from people saying, people are not understanding, they don't know why the film's so lengthy, what is this flashy style of editing, can we cut some and stuff like that, you know. So I'll just say, let's just give them 3-4 more days, you know. By which time, you know, the film settles down and people start talking about it. So both Varanam, Kaka Kaka, Vetiyada Velada, all went through the same thing. So I've gone through those moments. But I did mention, so those are okay moments where you go through some back and forth and stuff like that. But the last 2 years have not been really great. But what these 2 years have done is, it's completely given me a whole new lease of life. There was one point when I realized that I've hit rock bottom, and I sort of imagined myself looking down and thinking, I can't go any further down. Now I have to start climbing up. I really did say that to my partners. Because this was a, apart from all the other stuff that was going on, there was a police inquiry, and there was a, you know, it's just to threaten us and get us into that whole fear factor going and all that stuff. They put out a police complaint, completely false case. And there were a couple of cops who had called me also and said that we'll be sending some people home, so, you know, make sure you're there and stuff like that. But then, thankfully, having made Kakaka and Vetiyada, I've got some good police friends also in the industry, you know. So they called me and said, don't you worry, you know, we're all there. It's just a completely bogus case. So I walked into the commissioner's office the next morning and said, sir, this is what I've done. This is what they're saying. These are the papers. So I put it, he says, Gautam, we know you. Don't worry. You know, things are in control. Nothing will happen. Has there been any harassment from my side? He asked me. I said, no, not at all. So I really appreciate that. Please go home, he said. So we've been through the ups and downs. What I do at those moments is I try and stick with family. I try and stick with a couple of friends that really matter, and music. I made this whole talk about making my own music happen in those 2 years. You know, tunes opened up. I hired recording studios and sat with musicians and recorded. I got my friend Karthik to sing a couple of songs for me. I got Madan Karki and Tamre to write some lyrics for me. And nobody said, your songs, your music, why? Nobody said. They said, it sounds nice, let's just go for it. And they helped me, you know, ease over, you know, whatever I went through in those 2 years. So, to answer your question.
Sir, here. I'm diehard Tala fan. May I know what's the name of the movie? I'm eagerly waiting and expecting for that. I want the release date too.
No, frankly, we don't have a title as yet. I mean, there's all sorts of talk that we're going to announce a film and stuff like that. We don't have a title. It's one of those films that you know, to set up a title is taking some time because it's a story about a character. It's also a journey of a man, a boy who starts at 12 and what happens to him and stuff like that. So somewhere for now, we're not able to get a title as yet. So it's not like I don't want to announce it here or anything like that. I really don't have a title as yet.
Good evening, sir. Here, sir.
Hello. Just put your hand out. Yeah.
I'm your big fan and I watched all of your movies that are dubbed in Telugu. And my favorite is Raghavan. In the movie Surya Son of Krishnan, you showed a love story between Samira Reddy and Surya. Was there any love story in your life? Because you said the movie is inspired by your own life story.
There was no love story between me and Samira Reddy. I'll let me put on record. I have that thing about me, you know, people, at least in the media, you know, when I work with the heroines and the way I portray them, they think I'm having an affair with them, but that's not true at all, with all due respect to those women.
Actually, that was not my question.
Yeah, I know that. You were asking me if something from real life was there in that. No, yeah. See, I just equated it to first love. I've had my share of, like all of you, I've had a first love, you know. You know, your first love. The idea that it's a first love is also because that never happens, you know, that never ends in a happy ending, you know, sort of. Either the boy or the girl always walks away. So I just equated that whole what happened to me at 16, 17 to what happens to Surya. And I converted that girl going away to the girl dying because I think the same thing. So, you know, so that was the equation that I made. Everything else was just drawn from how two people would behave. You know, when he meets her, she says, I'm off to study in the US. And then he tells his dad, and dad says, just go, US is just here. So he goes to meet her. He's a guitarist, she loves him, and they get to know each other and stuff like that. They also decide to get married. They sort of become physical and all that stuff, and then she dies. So I equated that whole first love going away to death. And that's the only comparison from life.
Can we expect a third movie in the trilogy of police stories from you in the coming future?
I think in about a couple of months you'll see that, I think.
Thank you.
You said that Ajit sir called you and he wants to make a film with you. How did you decide, like, Ajit, a superstar is calling or you want, he will fit in your story like
that? No, thankfully, like I said, he's such a wonderful person. Not just because he said this. The first thing he said to me was, I want to be in your film. So let's make your kind of film is what he said. So that really helped, you know, more than anything else. But then obviously he's Ajit, so you need to make some stuff according to what you guys will want. So we've done that also, you know, in the film. So it's a little...
Hi, sir. This is Karthik here. I just want to ask you, like, how do you come up with name for your movies? They're just so unique and poetic.
Yeah, which is why I think we don't have a title as yet. I'm taking some more time on that. Normally, it just comes like that. I know, you know, when I made Varanamayiram and the story was about... a youngster and what he sees in life, and he finally ends up being in the Indian Army, and you know, and how he handles life and stuff like that. We didn't have a title for about a week, And somewhere I remembered when I was in college, somebody telling me about the Andal Tirupavai, and I realized, and I remember this line from it, you know, which talked about Varanamayiram, which means 1,000 elephants. So I just compared, you know, that to the protagonist. And I just called everybody and said Varanamayiram, and everybody said, Abdina enna? And if you pronounce Varanamayiram as Vanaramayiram, that means 1,000 monkeys. So, you know, and a lot of people end up saying that also, but I just thought, you know, it's so apt for the film. So a title will just come, like Vinithandi Varuvaya happened from the song from Minsara Kanavu. You know, I keep listening to a lot of music. So one day when I was just listening to a song, this title happened. And so that's how it falls in place. Just like everything else.
Sir, all of your movies are based in the urban milieu. Why haven't you tried one rural, like a Tamil film set in rural milieu?
I need to be calm.
I know that you just said you come up with your movies from real life experiences.
Yeah.
But why aren't you exploring?
No. Yeah, I want to. Also because I think they'll drive me out if I don't make a rural film. I'm already being sidelined. I don't belong to the Tamil directors, so to speak. I have this problem forever. I'm Gautam Vasudev Menon. My mother's Madurai and Tamil and all that. My dad's Malayali. I mean, they fell in love and got married. When I'm here, they say I'm a Malayali. When I go to Kerala, they say I'm a Tamil speaking guy, you know. So even there, you know, people don't take me so seriously. When I go to make a Malayalam film, at least 2-3 discussions, they think I'm just joking, you know. They don't take me seriously because you're making Tamil films. Why would you make Malayalam? And here, I know people have said, illa avaru Malayalinga, anala avaru kanda post kuduka venda and stuff like that, you know. So eventually that is the name, because I think it's not a dream or anything, but the way we speak, you know, like there's Tamil, there's a splattering of English, and there's Tamil and all sorts of stuff, there's Hindi, you know. So make a film like that and put it out on the global market. It's mostly to get out of here. It's the frustration of the past 2 years, you know, nothing else. So that I'm hoping that sort of answers your question. Yeah.
Sir.
Good evening, sir.
No worries, please sit.
Sir.
You are directing so many movies in different languages. In what languages you are more convenient, as you are Tamil guy?
Okay, if you... Again, she asked me a similar question. I prefer Tamil because there is a control over the market. There are actors who are accessible. And I can write in Tamil. I can think in Tamil and write. So I write the dialogues and it comes very naturally to me. Give me 2 hours to write a scene, I can write a scene, fill it with dialogues. It might not be nice, but I can write it, I'm saying. But when I made Yemayache Save, Netoveli Poindi Manasu and Garshana, I made sure that I work with good people so that the Tamil is converted into good Telugu. And I try and work with youngsters, you know, again, asking people like you to come forward and become writers, especially women. You know, I'm completely imploring young women to come into the industry to write, and because you guys have much better taste and aesthetic sense than us guys, you know. So I'm always looking for that writer who will sort of match my sensibilities, so to speak. They might be good or bad, but my sensibilities. So when I work in Telugu, I'm hoping to meet or get a writer on board who will convert that Tamil into good Telugu.
Sir.
So I've never found it difficult making a Telugu language film, even though I don't know the language per se.
Sir, here. Sir, I have one question. Hello, sir. Sir, this side. Sir, like if you have two stories which you like most, one will bag national awards more without box office records, but another one which can carry box office record without national awards, which one will you prefer?
That's a hypothetical situation. It doesn't exist. No, seriously, it doesn't exist because you can never know which film will work. Pardon me? Yeah, that's why I'm hoping to produce all my own films so that I can just get to make the films that I want. But I don't think you can ever say this film will work at the box office. And, you know, people who've said that have lost money, so it doesn't work. Okay, I made a film called Thangameengal. I don't know how many of you have seen it, Tamil-speaking people. It was a story of a father and a young daughter, his daughter, set in a small town that didn't have anything commercial written on it. It was a very simple tale of a father and daughter, and the father is a little wacky, and the daughter is finding it difficult to adjust to studying and stuff like that, and only he can understand her. And he goes through this whole argument with his dad about, you know, government schools and private schools and stuff like that. So the director narrated to me. I didn't think national award, I didn't think commercial or anything like that. I said, I will make this film, I will spend the 3 crores necessary for this film, and we did that. But I said, you act, because you narrated so well. You know, you carry this emotion so well. I don't want the actor that you're asking for. You direct, you act and you direct, I said, and we made that film. It made simple money, it did well in the theater and all that, but it fetched a national award, you know, so I'm happy we made that film at some point. Yeah.
Hello, sir. I'm here. I have two questions. One, like, I found Yettavalippayan Manasu so perfectly flawless, but why do you think it didn't do well at the box office?
I think it did well in Telugu and not so much in Tamil, right? It did a little better in Telugu.
Better in Telugu, but not
no,
as
no,
much
see,
as...
No, see, what I heard, if you ask me, if the feedback matters, what I heard was there was too much conversation. These two people are talking all the time. And I think for my kind of films to work, you need to have gone through that experience. Like all of you would have gone through what Karthik went through in Vinay Thandi Varuvaya. Some girl has always dumped you or ditched you and gone away. Or likewise for the girls. But in Yettavalippayan Manasu, the story of two people meeting at various points in life, they break up. If you look at it, it's such a fascinating tale of two people that I've been through and lots of other people I know have been through, but I don't know if the mass audience has been through something like that. Like, there is a moment in that film where she's actually a topper in class, she's finished her college, but she's waiting for him to finish his engineering so that whatever decision he makes, like if he's going to go into an MBA, she can join with him. But, you know, with the ego and the whole young feel, now they don't talk to each other about life and studies. Take every moment as it comes. So suddenly when he tells her that he's going to do his MBA and he's become the responsible guy because of this, of the situation at home, and he's got admission at IIM and Calicut and all that stuff, she's like, why don't you tell me? You know, I would also join with you. So he says, why would you join? Don't join because of me. She says, no, but I will join because of you, because I've been waiting. So I thought this was a great moment, but people just didn't get this. I don't know why. I mean, you know.
So that reminds me of that scene. Like, that's a single shot as far as I remember.
Which also people ridicule, saying, you know, why didn't you go close to the actors? I mean, that's the way I want to shoot that scene.
Like, how did you manage to tell the actors such a long scene?
No, I had the advantage of working with especially somebody like Nani and Samantha, who were so good with their lines. You know, they're so good with their lines. I give the lines much, much in advance. And they rehearsed and they did all the learning and stuff like that. So when they came, we told them it's a single shot sequence. It has to be done without any cuts. For Jeeva, we did some prompting on the spot, and he also managed, you know, quite well actually. Yeah.
And my second question is, can we expect Yettavalippayan Manasu original CD? We are waiting for it like hell.
Yeah, the original DVD, CD. Right? I'm sure it'll be out in the market soon. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hello, sir. I'm Onesh. Sir, we always direct with great actors or something like that. Why don't you come up with newcomers? I mean, why can't you direct movie with the newcomers?
No, again, it depends on that particular script at that moment.
No,
I started
do you really
a film
think
called
that they won't do justice to your script or something like that?
See, I had experience earlier on a film called Chennai Lor Mare Kalam. I shot for about 30 days. Completely newcomers, and I wasn't really happy. But that's again my mistake, because I should have trained with them. When you normally work with newcomers, you should train with them and set them up for 2-3 months. We didn't have the luxury at that time. So there's no stigma against working with newcomers as such. I think it depends on the script and stuff like that.
Hello, sir.
You can audition for it. Yeah, sure.
Yes, sir.
Hello, sir. Sir, I'm another diehard fan of yours. Sir, you and Harry, sir, used to make such a good films together. Like, I should say great. But recent times, I heard that you're not going to make any more films with Harry, sir. Like, is that true?
I think you haven't been reading the newspapers. This Ajit's film is scored by Harris only, actually.
Oh.
Yeah. I have a question. Are you contemplating to write a story where you can cast Mr. Rajinikanth in your movie?
See, again, these are situations that we'd love. Any filmmaker would love to do something like that. But then this call has to come from, you know, the superstar. It has to come from somebody like him. I can't put a script out and say, you know, work with me. Somewhere, you know, if he hears that there is an idea and then he calls. We've had a couple of meetings. I have had the good fortune of narrating a couple of ideas to him. But I'm sure there is a time for everything, you know. So, yeah.
Hello, sir. My question is, how is it that you're able to portray all your women characters so beautifully? Is it that you give special care when you write such women characters, or is it that it's inspired from all the beautiful women that you have come across in your life? That's
you said
my
it, man. You said it. I don't have to answer that. I have answered this question at IIT itself before.
Okay.
And somewhere in my speech, I should have just talked about that also, because today's, you know, youngsters is the mobile pulling out age and face where everybody shoots everybody else and stuff like that, which is so bizarre. I mean, you know. And all sorts of stuff happens with mobile phones and stuff. So somewhere, I don't want to sound, you know, patronizing or make the sound like I'm preaching and stuff like that, but somewhere you need to respect your woman, and I'm very, very sure of that. That, for me, it comes from the fact that I grew up with two sisters and a mother at home, and those values were sort of inculcated, you know. I was a protective brother. I was always making sure my sisters were not followed and stuff like that. And I didn't do anything like that with the women in my life. But somewhere I'm very, very conscious of that. So when I write, and more importantly when I shoot, you pick any film of mine, there will not be a single shot which sort of puts them out in bad light or even dress them up badly or anything like that. Everything is shot very aesthetically, and that's a sort of a condition that goes out, you know. It's but you said it yourself, yeah.
Well, sir, I have like three questions. First one was like, what about the Kollyar by Kalyan movie? And second was like, the newspaper says you are very strict with actors on the set, and you are also from ex-military. And third was like, when we expect one more Samantha?
I think the army thing is because of the haircut. I used to be in the NCC from the 8th standard, so I pretty much had the same haircut throughout. So I think people always think that I'm either trained to be a police officer or something like that. I've heard that before, but I wanted to join the army when I was 16, 17, but my girlfriend talked me out of it at that point. You know? So, Samantha, you'll have to ask, you want to know when I can make somebody else like Samantha, is it? I mean, those things just happen. She had it in her to sort of, you know, she's very good with lines and she's very dedicated and stuff like that. We've had the fortune of working with somebody like Nitin, who's very good, and it's a fun-filled action film. It's going to come out very soon, yeah.
Sir, so what do you think the responsibility of a filmmaker, what they are expecting to give the society, is it only the entertainment?
No, not at all. I think it's all that, right? It is entertainment firstly. There is a tax to it. It's called entertainment tax. So I'd like to classify this whole film you may experience as entertainment. Whether you're going to a theater and you feel sad, you're crying through the film, whether you hate it or whether you loved it and laughed your way, it's entertainment. That's how I look at it. But then somewhere, like I said, when I made Vetiyadu, I realized I should have toned down the violence. There's a way of shooting violence on screen. It's not because of the censor board. I'm not saying a censor board guidelines are all perfect and stuff like that. There is a way to shoot that. That's the responsibility of a filmmaker. The same impact or effect should go to the audience without actually showing the gore, without showing the sex, without showing the violence. And that's where a director comes in, the team comes in and saying, you know, we'll... Like for example, I don't need to show a knife going in. I can just show the face of the actor. And somewhere it's toned down, but you still get the idea. So somewhere there is a responsibility. There is a responsibility that, and I think this exists world over. You know, the censor board rules across the world are very different. But if you've got a classification of a PG-13 or a R-rated film or a universal film or an adult film, and accordingly take your kids or don't take your kids and be responsible and show them those films at a later stage in life. So I think, yeah, we are responsible to a large extent to the society. But then don't ask me to make preachy, moral-based film. I'm not interested in doing that also. Because then, you know, I'm classified as a... You guys won't like that also, I'm saying. So somewhere there is a responsibility, that's all.
Hello, sir. On a lighter note, we'd like to hear from you the song you sung for Raja, sir. Either any song or Nidane in Ponvasandam, if possible.
நீதானே எந்தன் புன்வசந்தம் புதுராஜ வாழ்க்கை நாளினம் சொந்தம் உன்வாசல் ஹே வரவேற்கும் அந்நேரம் உன் சொர்க்கம் ஹே அரங்கேறும் தேங்க்யூ
ஹாய் சார் Sir, you did films in Telugu, Tamil, Hindi.
I'm coming to a Malayalam film very soon.
Okay, that's the question, sir. But you didn't touch the Malayalam industry till now.
I told you.
When will you talk to sir?
No, I told you. I met all the big stars and everything, but they just didn't take me seriously. They were like, when you're doing so well here in Tamil, why would you do a Malayalam film and stuff like that? But off late, I don't know if you guys watch films, irrespective of language, the stuff that comes from Malayalam is outstanding. Please, in your spare time, you know, you don't need to know the language. My wife doesn't speak Malayalam, you know, but she watches more movies than me at home, original DVDs with subtitles, and she tells me, you know, watch this film, watch that film. Outstanding stuff coming from people like Fahad Fazil and Dulkar and stuff like that. So, yeah.
Hello, sir. Dear friend, 1 minute.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Here, a lot of hero heroines is there. Next, after Ajit sir padam, after you give to any opportunity for our IIT students.
I like you. I like your accent and everything. Maybe you should try first.
Thank you, sir. Another one important, my life happened. Once I am basically mechanical engineering. I am third year, I crossed from fourth year. At the time, I am 14 arrears I have. At the time, I am seeing first movie for in Salem cinema theater in their Minnale. So Madhavan telling, the Akpas will tell, I have 10 arrears. At the time, I told in their cinema theater, I have 14 arrears, every people seeing. Then after I shocked, okay, then after slowly I cleared arrear. After I coming back for first class. So I am not forget this situation.
Very happy. Clear your ears, right?
Yes, sir. Now I came here. Very good. Thank you.
Hello, sir. Sir, what inspired you then into filmmaking? Yes, your love.
See, I think that's one of the things that I want to somewhere mention, you know, but then I'm in the whole course of speech and I'm not so good at doing that, I forgot. How do you guys know at this point? I mean, I think you're all third year, final year, management, you know, post-graduation, stuff like that. How do you guys know, at which point do you think you'll know what is it that you're going to be in life? Irrespective of what field that you want to be in, but this is the point, I think, right? For me, it happened in college. I went into engineering, you know, thinking this is what my mother wanted me to do, and there was talk at home about engineering and medicine, and all my friends were moving into engineering and medicine. I know one guy went to do his law and stuff like that. But the minute I sat in college, somewhere I just started writing, and I thought I like what I'm doing. It was creative. I was writing short stories and stuff like that, and then I started watching a lot of films, and one of the films was Nayagan. Then I watched the Godfather series. I read a lot of books and stuff like that, and I realized this is a whole new world. So for me, it happened when I was in college. There was no inspiring factor or some particular person who said, you know, become a filmmaker. And it happened to me. Likewise, I'm sure at this point, you guys will also know, you know, that this is a step that you should take. And I'm saying, harp on that. I mean, insist that at some point now you guys should take that call in life. And not later realize that maybe, you know, there's no point in doing something that you're not interested in doing. 5-6 years from now or 10 years from now, you're sitting in an office. Or you're a filmmaker and you think this is not what I should have done. Think about it now, I'm saying.
One movie which you admire always. One movie.
There's a film called, it's an English film called, I'm sure some of you have seen it, it's called The Dead Poet Society. It's got Robin Williams, who just passed away. So it's my all-time favorite film.
Hello, sir. I have two questions for you. One being, looking at the movies like Garshana or Kaka Kaka, or as in the same, and Raghavan, where the you portrayed a woman to be tortured, and then looking at the films like M.I. Jesave or Etovalliva in the Manasu, like how do you shift the genre? Like you switch the genre from crime to romance. Like how did you do it?
It's not a conscious effort. It's what comes at that point, that's all. It's a spur of the moment thought. When I sit to write, I've said this before, I'm sure some of you have heard me saying this, when I sit to write, I just take the first thought and take it forward. Like, for example, when I decided I'm going to make a film at that point, the first words that came to me on the laptop was, "Ulagathil evlo ponnungirudhu naiyan Jesse love panna." Seriously. So I wrote that line, I looked at it and I thought, oh my God, I'm thinking about this girl and is this going in that direction? And I just took it forward. So it's the first thought that comes across that I like to take forward. There's no conscious effort as such.
We'll just take two more questions and we'll wind up with that.
Hello, sir. Okay, in the first. This is Vignesh doing your hated department, Applied Mechanics. Hello. Sorry. I pursued mechanical engineering and I was like greatly inspired by you. And I wanted to be a filmmaker like you. Like you see, I am wearing this gauch because of you. I was chasing you through your movies. Like, you have shown your house, offices, in all your movies. I was chasing you through the movies and I came to your office and home as well as. I don't know whether you remember or not. I just got an autograph of you as well as scolding from you. I don't know, like at this, even at this point I am doing my post-graduations. I am not like very much satisfied in what I am doing now. I wanted to be what I was thought. So what's the way like to approach you or come to you? And not like a producer, like you said, from IIT or IIM. I just want to be in the direction department.
See, it's not that difficult at all. If at all, I have sort of reprimanded you at that point, it must have been because that was not the right way to go about it. There is an office and there is a team that takes care of stuff like that. And anybody who comes in, irrespective, it always comes back to me at some point. Like people who want to act, people who have given their resumes for working on the direction side, everything comes back to me. So there is a proper system in place. So if you put it out in the right perspective, I think the other thing is, if you've told them that you're studying or you're working or you're currently finishing your graduation, that they won't have taken you seriously, because the rule is they finish and they come. You know, you finish whatever you're doing and then you come in, sort of thing. Thank you so much. I really loved this experience. Thank you so much.
A couple of announcements before you leave. As you all know, this is called SAC Middle Earth Student Activity Center, and this is a new stage that has been constructed. I'd like to inform you that this is the first ever EML that's been conducted in the SAC Middle Earth. May I now call upon Professor L.S. Ganesh to felicitate the speaker. Thank you all. You can follow our Facebook page to know when our lectures are scheduled and who's going to speak in the future. I request all of you to be seated until the speaker leaves. Thank you.